done the following. In ensuring financial inclusion, the bank is spearheading and advocating for SME development and financing. Government prioritized SME development over the last two decades due to its potential to contribute to job creation and poverty alleviation. However, access to finance has been identified as a major challenge for SME development in our country. In this regard, the Namibia Financial Sector Strategy thus recommends consideration for the establishment of a national risk facility to bridge the financing gap that is experienced by SMEs in Namibia. This work culminated in what we now refer to as the SME Financing Strategy, with three interlinked facilities aimed at addressing the multiple challenges facing SMEs. These facilities are the Credit Guarantee Scheme, the Mentoring and Coaching Program, and Venture Capital Fund. The strategy is being implemented by the Development Bank of Namibia as per cabinet direction. Bank of Namibia is taking a strategic approach to digital transformation, has put in place the Digital Transformation and Innovation Committee. The committee is designed to spearhead and facilitate initiatives in the bank with a long-term view to facilitate the same ambitions in the financial sector at large. One of the first tasks for this committee is to explore the establishment of a central bank digital currency. While this may be a long-term initiative, no time can be spared to start early to gain a thorough understanding of the legal, technical, technological and social impact it may have on the Namibian economy. The bank is also forming a view on crypto assets while continuing to monitor the impact of this technology. We agree that blockchain technology, the underlying technology that enables crypto assets, is an innovation that can be deployed. Additionally, advances in fintech are also increasing in the country, and a strategy is necessary to accommodate these emerging players in the market. We can do so by creating an oversight platform alongside other regulators to test new products and services in a controlled environment. These control environments are referred to as regulatory sandboxes, where fintech innovations can be tested in a controlled live environment with the bank's approval and cooperation between regulator and innovator. This is likely to transform the domestic digital landscape. The bank is also investigating instant payment models in countries such as Brazil and India for affordable payment infrastructure that can further advance and facilitate financial inclusion. We can learn from our sister central banks through close benchmarking initiatives. Cooperation within the SADC community on regional payment systems integration has grown substantially with the implementation of the SADC real-time gross settlement system to facilitate trade within the SADC region. Ladies and gentlemen, success in the digital age will not come without challenges and obstacles. Although technological change is essential for economic growth and sustainable development, it can initially widen inequalities. From a user perspective, recent technological advances could bring significant benefits that touch on all of the sustainable development goals. However, not everyone has immediate access to such progress, such as life-saving treatment, clean water, specific knowledge, or a prize of technology. If the dissemination of new technologies is limited to already advantaged groups, this could reinforce a vicious cycle that widens existing inequalities. For example, those with high incomes tend to be the first to adopt new technologies. Such differential access creates new opportunities in areas such as education, health, and employment for those already possessing an advantage. Therefore, to harness rapid technological change for inclusive and sustainable development, the government and other stakeholders need to ensure that on the user side, the benefits of frontier technologies reach the greatest number of people, and in particular, the most vulnerable and those further behind. We also need to ensure that rapid technological change results in more technologies is carried out alongside healthy competition to avoid excessive market concentration. This will require the government and other quasi-government institutions, as well as the private sector, to invest in infrastructure development to close the gap of potential inequality. A considerable number, about 50% of our population, lives in rural areas. While advances are likely to continue in urban areas, it is equally important not to lose sight of bringing citizens, all citizens, on this journey, no matter where they live. Access and inclusion in the information and communication technologies require national infrastructure that spans across the whole country. And we know we've got a vast country. To make it commercially viable, we need someone to invest in infrastructure. Another challenge we face in such a digitally advanced economy is people's privacy and safety. In a world where cyber threats are on the rapid increase, while plans are underway to modernize, we must think of building our digital infrastructure with safety and security in mind. Ladies and gentlemen, my remarks are not aimed at preempting the discussions and ideas that we'll have during the course of the symposium. They are not creating the impression that we know and have all the solutions with regard to digital transformation and how Namibia can exploit the opportunities fully. However, I believe as a bank central to the macroeconomic development of our country, we have a duty to spearhead these discussions and coordinate policy solutions. The symposium therefore offers us the opportunity to collectively reflect and deliberate on this important topic, particularly around the following questions, which I believe are crucial to transforming the Namibian economy and converting challenges into opportunities. What can the country improve on to leverage on digital transformation? Are there options for green ICT initiatives? Can we promote infrastructure sharing and penetrate the rural regions fully? How do we develop the necessary skills needed in the country? How do we, as regulators, create a conducive environment that fosters innovation and digitalization? In conclusion, I believe we have an opportunity to transform the Namibian economy through mutual opportunities. The road ahead is long and exciting, yet filled with challenges, but equally so, the opportunities are plentiful. We need to come to terms with the fact that the digital world touches all the spheres of life and will certainly, for the next 10, 15 years and beyond, shape the future. It then becomes important for our collective focus to be on execution and delivering on our respective mandates for Namibians with the digital future in mind. We must work together in all sectors and through all stakeholders to make the Namibian dream a reality. Let us leverage technology to help us exit the COVID-19 pandemic, mitigate the negative consequences of disrupted and lost schooling and teaching, and raise productivity in our economy. As we emerge from this pandemic, we cannot return to the old ways of doing things. As the cliche goes, not business as usual. We must therefore use the current challenges to transform our economy and adapt to the inevitable changes in order to create shared prosperity for all our people. To this end, it is my belief that while the pandemic has undoubtedly accentuated imbalance that existed for decades, it also presents an opportunity, particularly for developing economies, to ride the pandemic-induced digital wave as we chart new and creative paths that catapult faster and sustainable economic growth to improve the living standards of our people. I look forward to fruitful discussions on possible solutions. I thank you for your kind attention and profoundly welcome you to this event. Thank you.